Nay!
What do you want?
Bring me some reefers.
Oh, come on. Get a hold of yourself. Here you are. Let's quit that crazy laughing.
Where's Jack? I want to get out of here.
They'll pick you up and hang you if you don't pipe down.
I want to see Jack. Jack. I want to see Jack. Jack.
You better quiet him.
I can't do anything with him.
Something for you?
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. Play something.
All right. Come on.
The motion picture you are about to witness may startle you. Would not have been possible otherwise to sufficiently emphasize the frightful toll of the new drug menace, which is destroying the youth of America in alarmingly increasing numbers. Marijuana is that drug, a violent narcotic, an unspeakable scourge, a real public enemy number one. Its first effect is sudden, violent, uncontrollable laughter. Then come dangerous hallucinations. Space expands, time slows down, almost stands still. Fixed ideas come next, conjuring up monstrous extravagances, followed by emotional disturbances, the total inability to direct thoughts, loss of all power to resist physical emotions, leading finally to acts of shocking violence, ending often incurable insanity. In picturing its soul-destroying effects, its attempt was made to equivocate. The scenes and incidences, while fictionized for the purposes of this story, are based upon actual research into the results of marijuana addiction. If their stark reality will make you think, will make you aware that something must be done to wipe out this ghastly menace, then the picture will not have failed in its purpose, because the dreaded marijuana may be reaching forth next for your son or daughter or yours. Or yours. Hey there, YouTube. This is Bed Bath & Bongs here. Thank you for joining me. We're going to be looking at a little movie today called Reefer Madness, one of my favorites from when I was a kid. I wouldn't really call it a good movie, but it's definitely entertaining. It was originally released in 1938 with the title Tell Your Children. It was financed by a church group who was looking to scare America's youth about drugs and marijuana and that sort of thing. A contrary story that I've heard throughout the years as well claims that the U.S. government funded the film as a way to steer kids away from drugs. I haven't really seen much evidence for that, but that is something I've heard quite a bit over the years. Looks like in the 70s it was purchased by Mr. Dwayne Esper, who was known for mostly like exploitation and borderline pornography type movies. And he started showing it at marijuana legalization festivals and similar hippie type events until the film obtained cult classic status. So that makes a lot of sense. So in the movie, it's presented as a documentary, and it opens with a high school principal who delivers an almost like apocalyptic message regarding the evils of marijuana. And then you meet these different couples. You meet Bill and Mary, and then their drug dealers, Jack and May, who it's pretty crazy, because after smoking like a few joints, people just start raping and killing and hitting each other with cars. It's pretty nuts how quickly the mayhem unfolds in such an old movie. I guess that's what pot does. And beyond that, just one thing that gets me in this movie that I just find amazing is David O'Brien's portrayal of the character Ralph. He's the one who plays while Blanche is playing the piano. He's smoking weed manically and laughing and touching his face and just acting generally weird. His performance in this movie as a whole is pretty amazing. He provides 95% of the laughs in the movie. Just his facial expressions, how he moves. It can't be more of a mockery than what this movie already is, to be honest. And David O'Brien, he deserves some sort of reward, for this movie. Cause even though it's ridiculous, because I don't think pot anywhere affects anyone like this. The fact that he was able to do a halfway convincing portrayal of someone behaving that way. Pretty solid actor for his time, for sure. I mean, there are funny parts with other characters. There's a part where I think it's Blanche throws herself out of a window in the courthouse. But still, David O'Brien as Ralph just takes it away. Bravo.
Hey, Jimmy.
Yeah?
I've got to run over to Cedar Avenue for a minute. You've got a car, haven't you?
Why, yeah, my sister.
Mind giving me a lift?
Why, sure. Come on.
Okay.
And just so viewers are aware, for a movie from the 30s, there is a lot of implied banging. This is that borderline pornography stuff I was talking about earlier. So, you know, if you're into naughty flapper girls, this might be right up your alley.
Jack, I'm red hot.
Better be careful how you drive it. The first thing you know, you'll be ice cold. Take it easy, kid. Slow down, you'll kill somebody.
Five points.
Yourself.
Not gonna lie, judging by how boring the normies were in the 30s, I think I'd rather be one of these pot-smoking maniacs making out with chicks and, like, dancing like idiots. Seems funner to me. I don't know. And speaking of that, whole, like, borderline porn thing, like, for the 30s, how was this funded by a church? All this making out, the sinfulness, the dirty sinfulness.
Hey, what's the matter, an orphan?
Where do you put it? You got a hollow leg?
Woo-wee. Some crumble madness. Look at that. Ooh-wee.
Is she all right? She's dead. Nay, get me some water. Now listen, you two. Get out of here and leave forever in here today. I'll handle this. Now get going.
Harry. What happened?
You killed her. Look. After I scram, you call the cops. And this is your story. Remember it. These two kids came up here for a couple of beers. You're out in the kitchen, you heard the shot. When you got in here, that's what you found. Just stick to that story.
Mary, speak to me. Mary.
Sure, Jack, sure.
Okay.
Your Honor, I'd like to recall Dr. Alfred Carroll to the stand.
Call Dr. Alfred Carroll to the stand.
Mr. Carroll, as principal of the Lakeside High School, did you, during the last 3 months, notice any changes in the demeanor and attitude of your student, William Hopper?
Yes, in a number of things. For example, at times disassociation of ideas. In another instance, I happened to attend the recent interscholastic tennis matches. And while Bill Hopper had been considered an exceedingly good player, I saw him miss the ball by as much as 3 or 4 feet. This, I understand, could be attributed to the use of marijuana. It causes errors in time and space.
Objection, Your Honor. The witness isn't qualified to express opinions upon the effect of narcotics.
Sustained.
Dr. Carroll has been called merely as a character witness.
Well, then, although you didn't know to your own knowledge that the defendant was using marijuana,
did you notice any changes that would lead you to believe, as an educator, that he was under some severe mental strain, which might possibly have been induced by some drug?
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, have a duty to perform. A duty to yourselves and to our community. Mary Lane is dead. The evidence you've heard at this trial could not have failed to convince you of the guilt of the defendant. By his own admission, he pressed the trigger of the weapon that sent lovely and innocent Mary Lane to a tragic and untimely death. We are not so much concerned about the motives behind the deed as to the deed itself. While the defendant has told you that he saw someone attacking Mary Lane, and that his mind went blank from that moment on, the defense has been unable to produce one witness to substantiate that statement. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you heard able men testify at this trial, men who have tried to bring out the fact that the defendant might have become momentarily insane when he fired the shot that killed Mary Lane. But the defense has been unable to prove that he was insane. William Harper was sane when he visited the apartment where the tragedy occurred. He was in the habit of visiting the place. He was sane when he went into a bedroom with another young woman. You all heard what went on in that room. You heard it from the defendant's own lips. Involved as he was in a tawdry love affair, Mary Lane was in the way. She had found him out. In a moment of anger, he deliberately and willfully killed her. If such deeds are permitted to go unpunished, this community would cease to be a decent and safe place for us or our children to live. I do not believe I have to plead or even demand that you bring in a verdict to punish the defendant for the crime that he has committed against society. You are upright citizens. That is why you were chosen to judge another. And as honest, upright citizens, there is only one verdict which you can find, and that is a verdict of guilty.
And this court will be adjourned until the jury's verdict is reached.
I suppose you all feel the same about this case.
The defendant will rise. What is your verdict?
You find the defendant guilty, discharged.
Be over soon. Do you want me to play something for you?
Yeah, that's it. Play something.
All right. Come on.
what you want. You want to kill me.
You're crazy. Take it easy, kid. I just want to talk to you.
Before this court today, to what I hope will be the final actions revolving about an unhappy and unfortunate case, one whose horrible tragedy will forever remain with me. I am happy to have been enabled, before it was too late, to order the verdict of the jury in the case of the people versus William Harper to be set aside. But, young man, although this court is convinced that to declare you guilty would have been a gross miscarriage of justice, we cannot condone your acts. And we can express only the hope that your experiences may not alone keep you, but thousands of others from the vicious pitfalls of marijuana. Thus, I am ordering you to remain in this court during the next case, so that you will be obliged to witness what you yourself so narrowly escaped. Call the case of the people versus Ralph Wiley.
Bill.
Bill.
Your Honor, in this case, the state waives trial of the defendant, Ralph Wiley. It is convinced that he is hopelessly and incurably insane, a condition caused by the drug marijuana to which he was addicted. It is recommended, Your Honor, that the defendant be placed in an institution for the criminally insane for the rest of his natural life. Defendant, counsel, joins the state in this request.
Since counsel for the defense, as well as counsel for the state, seem to agree on this, I see no reason why the request should not be granted.
Yes. That happened right here, to your neighbors. It is not too much to say that in your hands lies the possibility of averting other tragedies like it. We must work untiringly so that our children are obliged to learn the truth, because it is only through knowledge that we can safely protect them. Failing this, the next tragedy may be that of your daughter, or your son, or yours, or yours, or yours.